Since 1941, more than 2.5 million fans have heeded the advice of Harry Carey and have clicked the turnstiles to see the stars of tomorrow. Over 100 Jamestown players have graduated to the big show, with Nellie Fox being the only one to go from Jamestown to Cooperstown. During the 60 years of history of Jamestown baseball, there are very few personalities who have risen to the level of Frank Wren. Frank was a player in 1978 and would be most valuable player. He was a coach from 1981 through 1983 and was general manager in 1985. Frank Wren has been and continues to be one of the fans' favorites. Frank has had a distinguished career, which has included the assistant general managership of the Florida Marlins, which resulted in the 1997 World Championship. Shortly thereafter, the doors opened wide for Frank Wren. Frank would spend a year as the general manager for the Baltimore Orioles. Then, after a not-so-interesting year in Baltimore, Frank moved on and became the assistant general manager for the Atlanta Braves, where he currently has a position. It all started in Jamestown in 1978, where he was assigned after graduating from St. Petersburg Junior College. Here, let's have Frank tell you the story.
I came here to play an outfielder, played for Pat,
mm-hmm.
and got a chance to. It was funny because basically back in those days, a lot of times we didn't have, I don't think we had the extra rookie club, and so we had 35, 40 guys here. And I remember I didn't play at all the first 8 or 10 games. I mean, not even pinch run, pinch hit, nothing, because we just had so many guys.
Mm-hmm.
And we were going to Auburn. I remember, just like it was yesterday, we're going to Auburn, and I started to get down because it wasn't going very well. And I went in and talked to Pat. We got the hotel in Auburn, and I went in and talked to Pat. I said, Pat, I know I'm not the worst guy on the team, but I mean, am I ever going to get in the game? He says, you're in there tonight, buddy. And so I got 3 hits that night. And so I think he put it back in the next night, and I got 3 hits again, or 2 hits, at least 2 or 3. I can't remember what it was. And then I started playing more, and then ended up having a real good year.
Yeah,
it was. Made the All-Star team.
Mm-hmm. And you were the MVP that year, right?
MVP that year, right.
And I'm interrupting this, but no. What's interesting, they always tell you who you can play. Mm-hmm. It's like with Rim, same thing with Gene Glenn. You know, they don't need to play, you know. If you need them, play them. And I mentioned I thought you were a middle infielder, but you ended up.
I started out second base, but I didn't play center.
And then you would play anything, so
right.
It didn't matter.
Right.
And then so we moved around. You had certain guys you had to play.
Right.
Which is
Tony Phillips, Glenn Bryant.
Yeah. So telling them. I couldn't think of Franklin, but
yeah, he was telling stories.
And then you ended up being the All-Star. That's how smart a manager Doherty was. You know, I got the guy sitting on the bench, and you know what happened? If you went 0-5, you know, you might not have got in for another 10 days, and pretty soon you're home.
Remember how I found out I made the All-Star team? We're driving to Niagara Falls, and Vince McNamara pulled the bus over. We're driving to Niagara Falls, and we just get outside of Buffalo, and
it's our last trip.
And the state police stopped the bus.
Yeah.
And it's Vince McNamara, and he didn't have time to go to the, because he was going to Geneva. He had to go to, I think he had to go to, what was the other team up there?
Geneva.
Just outside of where the Indians always were.
Batavia.
He had to go to Batavia to make a presentation. He said, I don't have time to go both places. He says, I'll make your presentation right here on this throughway. So we pulled off, and he asked me, and so Pat asked me to get the police stop the bus. So Pat says, Brandon, come here. I didn't know what was going on because the state police stopped the bus. In this manner, congratulations, you made the All-Star team.
Yeah.
Right on the side of the three-way. It was amazing.
That's terrific. And then next year, did you come back next year?
No, the next year I played in West Palm, and that's when my health problems started. In the middle of the season in '79 is when I had the first hemorrhage, which turned out later to be a brain tumor.
You played that whole year though.
I didn't play the second half. I came back and played at the end, but I missed 2 months.
Did you go back then after the operation?
Yeah, I came. I didn't have the operation for 2 more years.
Okay, then
yeah.
That's what I was
yeah.
going to say. When you really went down was in Memphis.
Yeah, in 81. And 79, I played the first half, and when I got sick, I was leading the league in doubles and stolen bases and first or second in average. And I got sick and missed about 2 months. And when I came back, I was about 20 pounds lighter than I was playing at. And I didn't play very well and didn't go to instruction league that year. And the next year, I came back to Memphis, and I felt pretty good and started feeling like myself and played decent the second half. And then the next year in spring training, I had another attack. And that's when they found out it was a tumor. And that's when I had surgery in 81 and then came here the second half. And
I was telling Greg that when you had called and said that you were sitting around and wanted to know if you could be a coach, that was in 80, that was when?
It was 81.
81.
Yeah, Geoff came to visit me in the hospital. And he kind of threw it out there. You know, would you want to do it? And I said, I'd love to do it. I don't know if I'll be able to do it. This was before I even had the surgery. I was still in the hospital before the surgery. And then it all kind of worked out after that.
That's Greg, I know I asked Fanning, and Fanning said, oh, we better not. Something might happen to him.
Yeah,
And you came with a patch over your eye. And
I couldn't buy double vision for about 6 weeks after the surgery. So I think the first 2 weeks of the season I had to wear the patch. I had to rotate it like every hour from one eye to the other. And then it started slowly but surely.
What were the symptoms of all this?
It came on with headache and projectile vomiting.
Mm-hmm.
So they knew it was neurological, something neurological.
Yeah.
And both times when I had it came on, it almost identical.
Yeah.
And so the first time they passed it off as meningitis or some bacterial infection. They really didn't know for sure, but they thought that's what it was. And the second time, once it happened again, then they knew it was something.
Yeah.
And that was sitting in a position where they couldn't pick it up on. It was very difficult to pick up, if I remember correctly.
Right, that's right. It was in the third ventricle of the brain. It was like the brain sits here, and there's a little ventricle that just where the folds are, and it was in that fold. And so the typical CAT scans couldn't pick it up.
And they didn't have MRIs.
And there were no MRI would pick it up like that.
Yeah, check.
But they took me from one hospital to the other, and finally the third hospital had a very high contrast CAT scanner, one of the most sophisticated of that day, and it found it immediately. So they did that CAT scan and found it immediately. So
size of a walnut?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It was a very, very delicate.
Yeah, about 8 hour surgery.
Right on.
And after that, I had a little deficit in my reactions, I felt later. I just never felt the same at the plate. I felt fine running, throwing, everything else. But I never felt the same as the plate.
Yeah.
And whether I gave it enough time or I don't know. But I played half a year in 82 and then Geoff offered me a coaching job to come here and coach with Moby.
Mm-hmm.
And so I coached here in 82, 83, 84. No, 82 and 83 following the 81 season with Pat.
Mm-hmm.
And then 84 I stayed in Gastonia and coached the whole year. And then 85 I came here as a general manager.
Mm-hmm. 1985 saw a career change in Frank Wren. For 3 years, he was a coach at Jamestown, as he indicated, and he was working under Pat and others, envisioning his next step as a minor league manager. However, that offer did not come, and in 1985, then Expos assistant minor league director Bob Gebhardt offered him the job in Jamestown as a general manager. Here are Frank's reactions.
Because I wanted to manage that year. I was going to manage Calgary.
Mm-hmm.
And Calgary got the AAA club. And so Eddie Creech went from Calgary to here. And that left me out of managing. And I was going to go, this is a funny story, I wanted to go manage someplace.
Mm-hmm.
So we were in the instructional league, and Pat and I would talk every day. You know, and Geb was kind of tough about, you know, that whole thing. And I finally met with Geb one day for lunch on a Sunday. And we came to agreement that he would let me go out and try to get him a job as a manager. That's what I wanted to do. But he didn't want to pay me. If I stayed, he didn't want to pay me any more than I was making. So Pat and I would talk. He said, we'll put the word out. So every morning, Geb would come in with those little pink slips for the telephone messages. Pat would write out, Chief Bender of the Reds called, Frank, call ASAP, and he'd leave it on the desk. And Geb would come in and he'd go, did you get this?
Who's calling Frank? Who wants Frank? That's Tamper. Do they know that's Tamper? I said, yeah, but I don't know anything about it. But the next day,
the next day, he put Marty Scott, Texas Rangers called.
And I told Geb, I said, you know, Geb, I don't know if, but there's a lot of people want Frank. I said, you know, we're going to keep him. We're going to have to give him some money. Well, he's going to get, Geb's old. You got $1,000. Don't ever play this back in Colorado. I'll be fired. There's always $1,000 with Geb.
Yeah.
Always $1,000, but anyway, so we kept leaving those notes, and he'd always, we're dressing for
Ted Ballerson, Kansas City Royals.
Yeah,
Bill Shreffy, Dodgers.
And Deb would always come in, and when he walked in, that desk was his.
Yeah.
So I'd always just leave the slip, you know, right there. And we're dressed, and he'd say, who's calling you now, Frank? Who's this? What's... So I told Deb, I said, you know, I think it's Coach Juan. You know, if we don't give him some more money. And then remember that day you were in the field, he had his briefcase out, and I'm walking by Edge in the batting
corner. Oh, I remember it.
And you got more money.
I got
like $1,800 risk.
Yeah, got something more. And that's the first day he floated the idea of me coming here at the Jamestown. He said, well, you ever think about being the general manager in Jamestown? And I said, no, never. I mean, that was the farthest from what I really wanted to do.
It was a great experience for you.
Oh,
look back now.
No question. Because what I did is I went back after he asked me. I said, well, let me think about it for a day or two. And I called a few people. And one of the people I actually called was Murray Cook. And Murray was the general manager of
the Yankees
at that time, I think. He might have been. Anyway, I called Murray because I'd known him in the past. And I know he had done something similar. He'd been the business manager in Gastonia, I think.
Yeah, that's right.
And so I called him. And I said, Murray, do you think that on the path I want to go, I mean, is this going to help me? He says, I'd do it in a heartbeat. Mm-hmm. Learn more. And he was right. I learned more in that summer here because you're a one-man show for the first three or four months. Then all of a sudden, you know, you get a few interns around. And
you moved up here. You got up here when?
Right after spring training, April 1st. Mm-hmm. I was the manager of the Jamestown team on the field in spring training. And then I left and came here to start selling advertising. And I had Larry Walker and Sergio Valdez, bunch of kids. It turned out to be pretty good.
Did you have Vanderwall?
No.
Here?
No.
Was Johnson here when you were here?
Randy Johnson? Yeah, 85. Well, the funny thing about Randy Johnson is when we signed him out of USC and Pat was involved in that, as far as the scouting standpoint, you know, our reports were obviously were great on him. But when he got here, he had a sore arm. And so Murray was given Jim a hard time about drafting a guy with a sore arm. Mm-hmm. And he was wanting Jim draft that he had a pre-existing injury closed. And so his bonus check was sent down to me like 1st of July.
You kept it in the desk.
And I had it in my desk drawer. And
okay.
I think it was 40 or 80,000. Well, okay. It's about 80,000, I think. Because he was a second round draft choice. And that time, I think it was about 80,000. And he would come in every day. And he said, did my bonus come today? I said, I'm still waiting for it, Randy. It's sitting right there in the desk drawer. and I'm waiting, and Jim Fanning would call every 3 or 4 days, and you know, he said, you haven't given that check to Randy Johnson yet, have you? And he said, they're driving me nuts here. He said, I don't know why they want to avoid this. He said, this kid's going to be a good pitcher. I don't know why they want to avoid this.
Mm-hmm.
Murray was really wanting
Gap
to avoid
too.
It. Was Gap too? I didn't doubt
it. I was field coordinator then.
Right.
And I can remember, and another thing, they really got down on him because at USC, he never touched the ball. He pitched the first game of a conference series on Friday. He'd start Friday and never touched the ball till the next Friday.
Right.
They just let him, well, here they're trying to get him to throw. We come in and throw 10 minutes and then day off in 10 minutes, and he totally balked at that.
Mm-hmm.
And then the pitching routine was where you throw every 5 days,
right.
You got a couple days off, you take your bullpen. He wanted nothing to do with that. And he was a...
He was different. He was a different kid.
Really different.
He was real different.
He was
very introverted. He was self-conscious about his height,
mm-hmm.
self-conscious about his looks. I mean, he was self-conscious about a lot of things. Really, he had some problems that he had to get over. And it's funny because I talked with him last week when Houston was in town. Totally different guy.
Yeah.
I mean, he's very self-confident.
Mm-hmm.
He's got a beautiful wife, 3 kids. He's happy as can be. And
if he can get a beautiful wife, then anybody in the world. But you know, he pitched 20 innings here. Did you see that? He pitched 20 innings here, allowed 25 hits, walked 24, and only struck out 23, and had an ERA of 5.5.
Bad.
I was thinking, he struck out 19 twice in his career.
Right.
And he struck out more in 9 innings than he did here. People wonder about Jamestown baseball.
Mm-hmm.
He lacked 2 of striking out in one game what he did here in 3 games.
Right.
Yeah, he was 0-3.
Thank you.
of 1998, various members of the Jamestown professional baseball community gathered together for an extraordinary evening of reminiscing. Frank Wren was one of those who made a special effort to get back.
This is Frank Wren. Frank Wren came to us in 1978, and Frank, I couldn't help doing some interviews, and so earlier this afternoon, Pat came down, hopefully willingly, and then Frank came down subsequently together. I heard a lot of stories. I promised that this would be private stock, that I would never show them. Not. The name Randy was a part of us. But ladies and gentlemen, I'm just thrilled because, to introduce Frank here, because I gotta tell you, it's not easy. Frank is the assistant general manager of the world champion Florida Marlins. Frank also wears a ring. Frank is required to be at all games of which the Marlins are at home. A tribute to Frank's tenacity, a tribute to his general manager who's got a sense of humor. One of the few times Frank has ever been away from the Marlins doing a home game is to come to Jamestown, because both David and Frank, I believe, felt it was important, and I am thrilled that he's here today. Frank Wren.
Very special night. Like Greg said, it's only the third home game I've missed in our history of our club. Our club's 7 years old, and all three of them have come this year. After the World Series, we've had a little bit of a letdown. I don't think the games are quite as important as they were in the past. And all three, last night I missed a game, and then again tonight. But Jamestown holds a very special place for me. It was a place where I really started out as a professional player and got a chance to establish myself somewhat. And also the people I met. I spent 5 years here, which in the minor leagues is a long time to spend in one city. Obviously only one other player. I spent 3 years here as a coach, and I came back as a general manager in 85. And I was the beneficiary of that stadium improvement. I was here the very first year the stadium reopened with the new facade and the new clubhouses and everything else. It was a beautiful new facility at that time, and was a great place for the guys to play. Our guys really enjoyed it, and one of them being Randy Johnson. Randy didn't enjoy it a lot because he was hurt the whole year. He didn't pitch very much. And the funny story is, the Expos were in the process of trying to void his contract. And his bonus check came in and it was in my desk. And he would come in every day and say, "My bonus check come today." And I hadn't been released by Jim Fanning to let it go yet, because they were still looking into releasing Randy Johnson. And so he would come in and say, "My bonus come today." "No, I haven't got it yet." And I've had that thing in my desk for about a month. And I just saw Randy last week when the Astros came into Miami to play us. And we were talking. He said, "Did you really not have my check?" And I said, "Randy, I had it for about 6 weeks, but I just wasn't allowed to give it to you." But quite honestly, one of the greatest times I ever had in baseball was here in Jamestown. In the 5 years I spent here, I got to know a lot of people. I've got a lot of very special friends. And one of the reasons I wanted to come back tonight, more so than anything else, was to be able to visit with people, see people that, you know, they're close and dear to me. And thanks for all your hospitality over the years. And this is a very special place for me. Thank you.
Thank you. just the other day, yeah, yeah, yeah. And it was so hot outside. Are you Good Friday? Don't remember you were talking, and I watched as sweat ran down your face. Reached up and I caught it at your chin, lick my fingertips. Just wasting time. Let the hours roll by, doing nothing for the fun. A little taste of a good life, whether right or wrong, makes us want to stay, 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 stay for a while. We'll be right back.
I'm Kristen Stein, director of the Fenton History Center in Jamestown, New York. We hope you've enjoyed this presentation, which is just one of many stories from our community's rich history. The Fenton History Center preserves our shared history through the presentation of educational programs and exhibits, the maintenance of a collection of local artifacts and archival materials, and a library specializing in local history and genealogy, all for the benefit and use of the public. For more information about the Fenton History Center and its activities, call 664-6256.